Picking up where we left off, let's remember our formula for elasticity of demand and then each of the three possible outcomes where we might be inelastic, elastic, or unit elastic. Okay, let's go for our first example. And the question is simply, is demand elastic, inelastic, or unit elastic? And we're given a demand function, we refer to it as x. Our demand function is x equals 1,875 minus p squared. And we're going to be looking at a price of 40. Okay, now thinking back to the elasticity of demand formula, you might be thinking, well, what is f of p? F of p is our 1,875 minus p squared. So typically it's called x, but you could think of that, well, that's a function of p, right? Okay, so there's the f of p we'll use in the formula. We also want to know f prime of p. So let's find f prime of p. Not anything very demanding here. F prime of p equals negative 2p. And so let's put it all together. E of p, elasticity of demand, equals negative p times f prime p over f of p. So negative p times negative 2p all over 1,875 minus p squared. And let's simplify that. Those negatives cancel out nicely. And we have 2p squared over 1,875 minus p squared. Okay, now this question was asking about a price of 40. So let's figure out E of 40. And well, we'll just plug right in. So E of 40 equals 2 times 40 squared over 1,875 minus 40 squared. And that turns out to be 11.6. That's been rounded to one decimal place. So just be aware of what the problem is asking. This one I didn't specify in the problem, but okay, let's round it to 11.6. That looks pretty good. That's plenty enough to answer the question, is demand elastic, inelastic, or unit elastic? You're like, well, that's greater than one, right? No matter how you round it, and the rounding's really not the issue here. That number is bigger than one. And that means demand is elastic. And if you remember, what does a demand being elastic mean, right? If we're bigger than one, elastic. If we were to increase the price, then we would lose revenue. Really, what's going on behind the scenes, our price is too high as it is. So we should lower that. The idea is if you lower the price, then your revenue will go up. You lower the price, and you end up attracting a lot more customers. Okay. And, oh, I've kind of got that note here. If the price goes up, then the revenue goes down. So we should do the opposite. We should drop the price, and that would mean our revenue will go up. You know, we would want to know that, right? If our price is too high, we might be thinking we're doing great, but actually we can make more money and sell more of our product, whatever it might be. Okay. There's another type of problem I want to talk about here in the lecture where they're not simply asking, is it elastic, inelastic, or unit elastic? Maybe we'd want to go a little bit further like this. Find the p-values where the demand is elastic and inelastic. So we're not setting a price point. We're saying, hey, what prices, what p-values would cause it to be elastic and what p-values would cause it to be inelastic? And well, really it's not said, but at the same time, we'll be able to figure out what p-value would make it unit elastic, which is really the ideal. Okay, so here the price demand function is x equals the square root of 3,600 minus 2p squared. Apparently, there's been a lot of research into our product and how much people are willing to spend, and our researchers came back and gave us this price demand function. Okay, so of course that is f of p. So let's go ahead and find f prime p. We'll want to think of that square root as if it's being raised to the 1/2 power, which would require a chain rule in the derivative. So what does that mean? So the 1/2 would come down in front, the power would drop to negative 1/2, and we would repeat the 3600 minus 2p squared right there for now for this step. And then we'd say, okay, that's the derivative of the 1/2 power. Now let's take the derivative of what's inside the square root, and it turns out to be negative 4p. And so simplifying that, and hopefully you can follow my algebra here. The 1/2 and the 4 would reduce to negative 2. And then you see I've made this big fraction, right? So the p would also go in the numerator, negative 2p. Because this whole thing has a negative exponent, I'm going to drop that to the denominator. And since it's a 1/2, at the same time, let's turn it back into a square root. So in the denominator, square root 3600 minus 2p squared. We've probably done plenty of these by now. Or hopefully that's starting to click, that algebra. Why rewrite it this way? Well, in a moment, we're going to have to plug this into a bigger formula, and we're going to have to plug in, we're not going to plug in a value for p here, actually, but we're going to have to solve for, these p values. And so a lot easier to think of it written this way, in my experience. Okay. So let's put together our E of P, and this one is a bit of a beast, but nothing we can't handle. E of P would equal negative P times our derivative right there over the original function. And you notice I put that original function over 1. That's going to help us out here simplifying this thing, because we do not want to tackle it the way it is written like that. This will clean up actually fairly nice. Okay, again, negative p, f prime p over f of p, and I just went ahead and put that whole thing over 1. Why would I do that? We're going to start to clean this up. So I'm going to think of this p here. I'm going to think of the negative going with this p. And then I'm going to put that over 1. Then I'm going to multiply that by this fraction. So I got like fraction times fraction. And then I'm going to take this fraction here. And because it's in the denominator, we can flip it over. So times 1 over square root 3600 minus 2p squared. So I'm thinking of each of these as a fraction all being multiplied. Of course, that one on the bottom needs to be flipped. And this is really going to clean up well when I multiply all those fractions together. Notice how it comes out. E of p equals, well, hey, in the top, oh, looks like I forgot the 2. The negatives cancel, and I get 2p squared. And in the denominator, notice I've got a square root times itself. So when we multiply this square root of 3600 minus 2p squared by this square root, 3600 minus 2p squared, it's like we're squaring the square roots. They cancel, and all we've got is 3600 minus 2p squared to the first power in that denominator. And that's going to be so much easier to work with than this original for where we need to go next. Okay, so in this problem, it did not have us, it doesn't have us plugging in a value of p. Instead, it said find the p values where demand is elastic and inelastic. So what are we going to do with that? I'm glad you asked. Let's look at elastic. So we know that elastic means our elasticity of demand equation is greater than 1. So I'm just going to repeat What we just found, right? 2p squared over 3600 minus 2p squared. If that is greater than 1, then our demand is elastic. So let's solve this inequality for p. And it'll tell us where we're elastic. Okay. So we just set up our elasticity of demand as greater than 1. Well, what are we going to do from there? Let's multiply this denominator over to the right side. 2p squared is greater than 3600 minus 2p squared. We can add this 2p squared over here. 4p squared is greater than 3600. We can divide by 4. P squared is greater than 900. And finally, we can take a square root. And we've solved for p. P is greater than 30. Those are the prices that would cause our demand to be elastic. And remember, demand being elastic, that's when if you were to raise the price even more, you would lose revenue. And really, the truth is, you should drop your price to find the sweet spot. Hey, if P being greater than 30 is elastic, then what would be inelastic? Turns out we don't need to do any work at all. We just flip the sign. If P is less than 30, you're inelastic. Couple ways we could explain that. For one, you could say, well, if greater than 30 is elastic, then automatically P less than 30 is inelastic. And it hasn't been asked in the problem, but I decided I'd put it down here anyway. Unit elastic is when P would equal 30 itself. So there's only one value of the price where you're unit elastic. It's just one number. But inelastic, elastic, inelastic are these ranges. So anything above the unit elastic is elastic. Anything below unit elastic is inelastic. So by that argument, you can say, well, if you're greater than 30, it's elastic. Well, then less than 30 is inelastic, and equal to 30 is unit, where we maximize revenue. To explain it a different way, we could have set this up differently from the beginning, our inequality. We could have been looking for when it's inelastic, and that would just change the inequality. But as far as our work goes, we would be doing all the same work. We'd just be working with a less than sign every time, and we'd arrive at p less than 30 is inelastic in the same way that we did. And so there's really no reason to repeat that. We can see that all right here. Okay. Hey, that's all I've got to say for 3.7. So go check out the homework and good luck.